This probably is the greatest picture of that era of musicians I think ever taken. And I'm so proud of it, because now it's all over the United States, probably the world.
I was a young boy, see?
As I recall, it was very early.
Early in the morning, 10 o'clock or something like that.
But it was like a family reunion, you know, being in one spot with all these great jazz musicians at one time.
I mean, what we call big dogs. I mean, the giants were there.
Prince.
Monk.
I looked around, and there was Count Basie.
Hawk.
Charlie Mingus.
Steph Smith.
Dizzy Gillespie, Jerry Mulligan. I said,
what a lineup.
Can you imagine if everybody had their instrument and played?
Back in 1958, when New York was still the jazz capital of the world, you could hear important music all over town, representing an extraordinary range of periods and styles. This film is the story of a magic moment when dozens of the greatest jazz stars of all time gathered for an astonishing photograph.
This thing all started, I guess, in the summer of 1958, at which time I was not a photographer.
Art Kane went from this day to become a leading player in the field of photography. This was his first picture.
I was an art director, a fairly well-known art director. I was art director of 17 magazine.
He was one of the two or three really great young art directors in New York at that point. Henry Wolfe and Art Kane and one or two other people were really considered the bright young Turks.
Robert Benton had not yet become a celebrated Hollywood filmmaker. He had only just become Esquire's new art director, hoping to please his jazz fan boss with an idea for an all-jazz issue. But his inexperience, combined with Kane's inexperience, gave us this historic document.
I was new enough and dumb enough in those days that I was willing to try all sorts of risky things.
So Benton suggests to, I guess it was Harold Hayes, who was the editor at the time, hey, why don't we give Art Kane a chance? He's never worked before professionally, but he's got a lot of talent, and he loves jazz, you know.
I called Art and asked him if he would come and talk to Harold and photograph this section.
So I suggested that we start this story off with a gigantic spread whereby we get together every jazz musician we can possibly assemble.
But instead of doing it in a control situation of a studio.
I didn't have a studio. I was not even a professional photographer in a studio.
Art then said he wanted to do it up in Harlem.
Harlem, that's where jazz came in New York.
That was the moment where I began to get very nervous, because we will never be able to control this up there.
And so began a great day in Harlem.
Ah, yeah.
Do you remember anything about how you got there, Dizzy? Who told you to come and how you showed up so early?
No.
Whatever you remember about the day this picture was taken, how you happened to be standing up there with those guys.
Honey, I'm trying to forget it.
I was staying up in 153rd Street, right across from where Coleman Hawkins lived. I probably took a taxi down, or I don't know.
I came with Taft Jordan and the gentleman on my left. We all came together, and I stayed till about 2 hours, I guess, and I had to go to work.
Nat Hentoff had come around saying, well, if you want to have your picture taken for Esquire magazine, be at Lenox Avenue and whatever it was, 125th Street, I think.
This was a remarkable idea, and that's why I showed up there. I thought I was so fascinated with the idea that I can't believe all these people are going to show up. There they were.
What time was it called for? I can't remember. About 11?
10.
That's early.
That's probably why I didn't believe anybody would show up.
In those days, you know, most musicians, and myself especially, get to bed, say, 4 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, one didn't go to sleep immediately. It took a long time thinking of the day's happenings. And so you'd wake up, as a rule, 12 or 1, ravenously hungry, go off to have something to eat, and wonder, you know, what you were going to do with the long day coming.
I was hanging around with Willie LaLonde Smith by that time. So I came down with him, and then it was only later on that I realized that this was for Esquire and who the, most of the rest of these people were. Because at that time, I was really only interested in stride piano. When you hear voicing like this, was one of the first stride pianists.
Lucky was, in his time, a legendary pianist. There was nobody who had the reach and the imagination. I mean, the Lion was good, but Lucky was the stride pianist.
He was 5'2" or 5'4" or something. He was very short. But he was very powerful. There was a story, he was a gymnast earlier on. And there was a story that was reported in Rudy Blesch's book, They All Played Ragtime, that Lucky Roberts was walking alone at night, and these young thugs were gonna mug him. And he succeeded in grabbing both of them, breaking their bones, and dragging them into the police station.
They picked this particular street or this brownstone, but that was the case. And here's my dear friend Scoville Brown.
I think I was residing at Pop Collins' house, which was a notorious home for musicians where you could come eat and sleep for a reasonable sum. I think his dinners were 35 cents apiece, and they were out of sight. And the rooms might have been, let's see now, rooms might have been $8 or $9 a week.
It was important for me to live in New York because I was just building a reputation for myself, and the, you know, the record companies are here, and the booking agents are here, and all the clubs are here, and plus all the inspiration.
Because living in New York at that time, you saw everybody, everyone there, you're allowed to run into them any day.
It is true that we all had more chances to get together in those days.
As I say, we were up all night. I don't know one person who was not up all night because they were all very busy playing, you know. And the extraordinary thing about this picture is that there are so many innovators.
I was working with Thelonious at this period, and we were working in a fire spot. And so that's probably how I heard about it.
Well, Bob Altshuler was the publicity guy at Riverside Records, and he was in charge of getting Monk.
I received a phone call from Esquire magazine to see whether it might be possible to arrange to bring Thelonious Monk on a certain date for a special photograph that was going to be taken. And knowing how difficult Monk can be.
Monk had this facade, the way he walked around, looking like maybe Jomo Kenyatta. People are afraid to speak to him, you know? And he's doing certain things, eccentric type things, you know?
I really love Monk. I hung out with him. Because he had higher morals than any man I ever met.
Really?
He was something else. And he always told the truth. If you want to know something, and you ask him a question, if you're ready for the answer, he's gonna tell you the truth, and that's what people don't like. That's why.